Hi, I'm Dr. Gina Mackenzie, host of the Philadelphia Cultural Forum on CCP-TV, the educational channel of the Community College of Philadelphia. Tonight we are honored to have with us Lorene Cary. Lorene was born and raised in Philadelphia. She is an author, educator, and social activist here in our community. Mm-hmm. She is the author of 5 books, including her memoir, Black Ice, The Price of a Child, Pride, Free, a collection of slave narratives for young adults, mm-hmm. and her latest book, If Sons, Then Heirs, which debuted in April of 2011. Mm-hmm. She has written for Essence Magazine, Mirabella, Obsidian, American Visions, and the Philadelphia Inquirer. She holds an MA from the University of Pennsylvania and another MA from Sussex University in Victorian Literature. She is currently a senior lecturer at the University of Pennsylvania and is also the founder of Art Sanctuary, an African American Arts and Letters Association. She's here with us tonight to share from her new book and to talk about Art Sanctuary. Thank you so much for coming this
Thank
evening.
You. Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure. So, what's the job of a writer?
Oh, I think the job of a writer is to create a beautiful piece of work from words. I think the first job is to create beauty.
It's lovely. Yeah. What makes writing beautiful?
Many things. So there are many ways to make it beautiful. There is craft as well as art. I don't think art can be beautiful if it is dishonest to our human experience. So there can be, you know, and as somebody who runs Art Sanctuary, so, you know, you're filming this, we're right in the celebration of black writing, and we're doing all kinds of different genres. There are so many ways to be honest to our human experience because it's complex, because you've got to hit intellectual, emotional, spiritual, physical, and different artists are able to go at all of those levels differently.
So writing doesn't have to be beautiful in the sort of conventional sense of beauty.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no.
And doesn't have to be realistic in order to convey human experience.
No. You can do writing that's the linguistic equivalent of ash can. It can be very harsh. It can be dissonant. It can be fantastic. Science fiction. But it has to be true to our experience as human beings.
And certainly there is in your writing harshness and dark sides of humanity.
Yeah.
But very honest work as well. And that's what makes it so powerful.
Right. I hope so.
And I think that's what draws your readers in.
I hope
partially.
So. I hope so. That's always something I'm working on. I remember Price of a Child is about a woman who escapes slavery. And I remember being on a talk show, African-American talk show. It was WURD here in Philadelphia, in fact. And a man called in and he said, "I don't want to read this book." He said, it's not true to slavery. It's not. And the host said, wait, it just came. Did you read the book?
Yeah,
and he said, no.
Judge?
He said, no, I don't want to read the book.
Why?
Because if there's a book I can read about slavery, if I can read it and I can enjoy the experience of reading, that I don't think it's true to slavery. So it ended up being, you know, a theological discussion about what do you believe in literature. Can it be a pleasure to read?
Can we take pleasure in the pain of an experience almost then?
Right. And our point was that it is literature, it is art, it's not a smut film, and that we do not take pleasure in real violence.
Right.
But because we don't take pleasure in it, you almost can't learn from it. You can't sit still long enough to take it in and understand it.
So is another job of reading to teach something to the audience?
Well, I think the job of writing is to learn. I don't know if I'd go as far as to say the job of writing is to teach.
So what have you, in the myriad of topics that you've explored, and certainly the research that goes into your books, mm-hmm. historical mm-hmm. and legal now mm-hmm. with your newest mm-hmm. book, what are some of the things that you've gotten to learn?
I love facts. I started as a journalist. I still write magazine stuff. I love real facts. You know, like Dostoevsky, right? Give me the facts. So I learned that in different bodies of knowledge, legal, historical, geographical, learn about animals, learn about diseases, the human body, astronomy. I'm just trying to think of all the things that I study. I remember studying just what people ate in certain regions and times, learning how many farm accidents there were. Because all the older men I knew who came from the country, not all, that's a lie, it's a lie, but more older country men than younger urban men, when I was growing up, had fingers missing. I've done all this research to find out about farm accidents and how many, you know, because you don't want to put in too much, but, you know. So
you want to be honest right. To the experience.
So that's the external. That's, you know, like actors who put on the nose and the mustache and then they're ready to do Lear, right?
Right.
There's also the internal learning, because a lot of what one is doing is sort of dropping the bucket down into mm-hmm. the well, or mining your emotional and spiritual landscape.
Well, and certainly in Black Ice you had to do that.
That's for sure, for sure. In fiction you do it absolutely as well.
Can you explain why?
Because when you make up things, it's easy to cheat. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So instead of, if in Black Ice, I remember someone saying, wow, you know, you this experience, I don't know exactly how it came up, but they were comparing Black Ice to another book written around the same time, which was about a young man who had been at Exeter and had died because he'd gone home and gotten in some deal on the street and there were guns and he was shot. And this person said, well, they made a TV show out of that, but yours isn't as interesting because you're still alive.
God.
I said,
that's
yeah,
awful.
It's more interesting to me, I said, like that, right? I like it this way. But I think the point was made that it's more dramatic when there's some big thing.
Oh, certainly.
Right. So in fiction, sometimes, instead of just staying with the emotional story you mean to tell, it is possible to leave that emotional story.
And go for the big bang.
And go for something else. Yeah. And that one can be seduced into that. You know, you think about sales, you think whatever people think about. So a lot of writing, a lot of the discipline of writing is to
block that
to
out.
Do the opposite of what I'm doing now, right? To go where nobody is looking at you. And even in your own head, nobody's looking at you.
So you mentioned craft a few moments ago, mm-hmm. also, and how beauty can be found in craft.
Mm-hmm.
How do you actually sit down to craft a novel? Are you very regimented? Do you do outlines, or do you sort of?
Oh, keep doing your bullet points. Absolutely.
So you do all of the very practical writerly things that we teach in class.
Amen, amen. Yes, yes, yes. Tell everybody, do those things. Do those things. Do them. Do them. Do them. Well, so you do them. And then there's a structure.
Well, there's some kind of magic that has to happen then too, right?
Yes, yes. I think I was about to use the word inspiration, which I very seldom use, but I mean it almost spiritually. I say that and I breathe in. You know, when you sort of breathe in whatever gifts there are in the universe, you can breathe them in with the structure.
And then that allows...
Right.
That sort of esoteric part to come through.
Mm-hmm. And then it knocks everything out of place. It's totally bowling. It's bowling. It's, you put it up.
That's a great
and it just,
image.
Yeah. But if there's nothing built, then you have nothing. You don't know where to begin the work. You don't know where to start climbing. I map out the climb. Now, I don't know what I'll find, but I do have to map. What's the book going to be? How long is it going to take me? What are the questions I'm going to ask? What are some of the formal? Because there are formal challenges.
Sure, things like point of view.
Yes.
All of the narrative structure elements that have right. to go into something.
And what are the learnings? In this book, I started very early, if sons, then heirs. I started trying to figure out, I decided I had to write a male character that I believed in and that other people would believe in. Because I wanted a male voice. I wanted to get that. It took a long time. You know, just having that goal is, you know, that's like a goal. That's like saying I want to stay married. Yeah. Yeah, what are you going to do about it? How are you going to do that? So it's, you know, you set the goal, and then you have to figure, then you decide all kinds of things you have to do to get there. I do exercises for myself.
You still do writing exercises?
Completely. I make up new exercises.
Oh, that's great.
For myself. I am my own special ed. This is what it is, because you're trying to learn stuff that you don't know, and you don't know how to get there, and it is, when I say special ed, I don't mean that disrespectfully. I mean, how is my mind working? How is it not working? What am I understanding? What don't I know? Well, if you don't know it, how are you going to get there? Whom do I need to ask? What do I need to read? Formal failures do I need to study and assess? Like, why did I do that wrong?
Interesting. Yeah. So learning from yourself and continuing to explore.
Right.
And certainly in If Sons Then Heirs, you have a wonderful male character.
Mm-hmm. I hope so. Thank you. Bless
how
you.
Did you find this male voice? Is
I
it
actually,
difficult?
Well,
as a
it
woman.
Is. It is. People say, oh, what about, you know, having white character? That's not as hard as going gender, really.
Interesting. Because race is something that's a consistent theme in your work.
Yeah.
And certainly is handled with grace and power. But gender doesn't always come to the fore as easily.
Right. I think the what I studied first in my own life was race, and I needed to grow. I think I needed to raise kids before I was able to really understand gender well enough to write it.
Interesting.
Because and there are a lot of research studies that show that for some women, gender is enforced by childbearing. So I could do a lot of man life before kids. Mm-hmm. I was ambitious, I worked hard, but when I had children, some people are able to switch genders in their marriages and their relationships. Mm-hmm. I was not, I was mom. And that was enforced for me. I remember when I was pregnant, looking out the window and knowing that I would never, ever be able to be free in the way I had been before. That I was, and all the metaphors came, I was dropping anchor right here. Mm-hmm. I was tied to the, whatever happens, I will not step away from my children in a way that I would be different if I were a man.
And so then that changed your writing perspective as well when it came mm-hmm. to write this character and this particular novel.
Yeah.
Has it been a fun journey to explore that male perspective?
Oh, yeah. Took too long.
Been too long since your last book, but we're glad this one is here now.
Thank you. Yeah. Also, there are two men, and the first man I got to know was in the 1930s, was King, was the great-grandfather in South Carolina.
Is he the first character that you conceived
yes.
of in this novel?
Yes.
Interesting.
He and his second wife, Selma. That was the couple. And I always think of characters in relationship. They're never individual.
You mentioned the word inspiration a while back mm-hmm. and looking at formal failures, as you mm-hmm. called them. Mm-hmm. To what other writers do you look for inspiration? Or to what other artistic forms?
Oh wow. I don't know that I'm smart enough to answer this question fast.
Who do you like to read?
I rest on, just like you rest on your childhood, mm-hmm. I rest on my early reading.
So is that Victorian literature then?
A lot of Victorian literature. A lot of early 1930s, Richard Wright, Zora Neale Hurston.
Fabulous.
George Eliot, Charles Dickens. James Baldwin. Those are
interesting mix of characters.
And Hemingway, Langston Hughes in poetry.
Wide range of styles, certainly,
for sure.
Drawing from Baldwin to Fitzgerald, back to George Eliot.
Yeah. George Eliot and Baldwin, that's the marriage. If the two of them, that's a very, you shouldn't think about the two of them mating, but that would be me, I think. In my heart of hearts. And Tolstoy, oh my gosh, Tolstoy. Because when I finish a book, first thing I think is, once again, it's not Baldwin, it's not Eliot, it's not Tolstoy.
It's just you, and that's a good thing. Oh. So we've been talking a lot sort of around your latest novel. Could mm-hmm. we hear some of it now?
I'd love it. All right. Mm-hmm. All right, I'll start from the beginning. I'll read a little bit from chapter one, and then I'd like to go to another section that talks about South Carolina. The book takes place in Philadelphia with our character here in the present, and in South Carolina where he was raised, both in the present and with his great-grandparents in the past. Jewel Thompson nosed her sedan into the narrow Philadelphia street. She had directions on the seat next to her, and also the letter. In her mind, a voice from the past, her grandmother's, shouted, "We home!" Which was ridiculous, since she'd never been on this street or even in this section of the city before. Outside her noisy mind, rows of identical two-story brick houses squatted beside Cobbs Creek Park, muffled by heavy fog and a cold early spring, early Sunday morning quiet. She had to drive cautiously. No more than 4 or 5 inches separated her driver's side from the curb or her passenger's side from the parked cars, whose owners had carefully folded in their side view mirrors. She slowed nearly to a stop when she saw house numbers that matched the return address on the letter. They were gold and white, painted onto a glossy black brick face. Prim white sills and lintels like shirt cuffs shone through the drizzle, and white lines traced the mortar. When she'd left her house, Jewel had told her husband that she might, depending on the way things look, knock on the door. Now presented with this reality of a shiny black cookie jar of a building on the misty working-class West Philadelphia street, she doubted she'd have the courage. The letter said, "Dear Mrs. Jewel Thompson, I am looking for my mother, formerly Jewel Needham, the daughter of Bobo Needham, originally from the town of Gunnison in Beaufort County, South Carolina. Please let me know if you are that lady. We lived in New York in Harlem, I think, until I was about 7. Then I was sent to my grandfather, Bobo Needham, and his stepmother, Selma Needham, in South Carolina, who also raised him. Now I'm 30 years old. I'm doing well. I'm a contractor now and just received my first contract with the city of Philadelphia. I said that I wished I could tell you, and my girlfriend suggested that I write this, and she would try to find an address for me to send it to. I live with my girlfriend and her son. He is about the age I was when I was separated from my mother. That's another reason I'm writing. Watching him grow has made me think about you. I hope that you will agree to meet. If you are not the right person, please let me know. This could just be one meeting if you like. Doesn't have to be more. Here's my information for home or work. Email is best or cell. Sincerely, Alonzo Rain." A truck drove up behind her. That was Lonnie in the truck, behind Jewel. She knew it. Jewel remembered her son's deep-set, coffee, black-brown eyes like her grandfather's. A big gap between his front teeth came from her grandfather, too. When Jewel had allowed herself to think of Lonnie as a man, she'd fitted his 7-year-old face into the image in her head of her grandfather King's old sepia-toned photo. Nana Selma had had a mantle built, sans fireplace, just to make the proper display, like an altar for that photograph. It had been taken by a black photographer in Columbia, whom Selma referred to as famous. Later, when Jewel learned about African ancestor worship, she thought of that photo. Surely, the hulking farmer in his white shirt and stiff collar had seemed to live with them, Selma spoke to him as she walked by. She asked questions of him in passing and seemed to receive answers. King had been a big, pale man, burned bronze by the sun. His head and neck and shoulders filled the frame. The wide mouth and jaw were set as if against a coming misfortune. His deep-set eyes looked straight and unsmilingly from under dark, arched brows into the small room that his father had built and that he had improved. Jewel had been afraid of those eyes and their judgment. Now she was similarly afraid of her son's. His letter had been perfectly cordial, but surely he had to remember what she had done, just as she remembered and could never forget, starting with the train. Jewel had put him onto that southbound train and convinced herself that he'd be riding into a new, wholesome boyhood. He's much better off. Recalling how far she'd sunk back then, she repeated it to herself through the years, much, much better off. And until this moment, she'd mostly been able to keep herself from thinking about how very deeply he might hate her. She stopped the car and watched him in the mirror. It looked as if he were even taller than her father, big and hulking like him, with a walk that rolled his shoulders side to side. On his head, he wore a skull cap stretched over thick dreadlocks that reminded her of how unruly his hair had been when he was a boy. He unloaded from the back of the truck two boxes, walked them to the black and white house, and rang the bell. A young woman peeked her head out into the drizzle. Slim, brown, animated, she waved her hands as he shook his head no. She had big hair too, twists or some similar style that poked out in all directions. She stepped onto the stoop and clearly strained to pick up the box and take it inside. They were open boxes filled with objects Jewel could not identify, except to see that the heavy contents seemed to slide when the young woman tried to pick up the top one. He called to her. Jewel saw his raised hand make a dismissing movement, which the young woman ignored again. Instead, she called into the house. A boy of about 7 erupted from the doorway, danced a little moonwalk on the top step, and then held the door for her, hands and legs moving in place. With that, she bent deep and hoisted and then carried first one box, then the other. Once that woman finished, the boy banged the door closed, ran shouting into the quiet street. Lonnie, Jewel called him that in her mind. Lonnie pointed to the truck bed and spoke to the boy. It looked as if he were directing him to carry something else into the house. The boy climbed up onto the bumper and reached in at the same time that Lonnie pulled out another box. Instead of grabbing his own parcel, however, the child vaulted onto Lonnie's back, laughing. Lonnie bent forward slightly to accommodate him, said something to him sideways, and then stopped in the middle of the street to regard Jewel's car and the woman inside it watching him. He squinted pointedly through the dim, drizzled light at the rearview mirror and opened his big hands in an impatient gesture that communicated, "What are you looking at?" to Jewel. Flushed and embarrassed, she took off fast down the one-way street. The next intersecting street went the wrong way and aimed her back to the expressway. One more block took her, and she drives around, and then, I'm making a quickie, go right to it. She decided she was trying to get back to his block, and she couldn't quite. She wanted to see him again, it says, up close. She wanted to feel again the totally undeserved surge of pride that filled her as she'd watched him with his rolling gait and strength. And his relationships, whatever they were, with the young woman with hair as big and wild as his own, and the boy who whooped with glee and jumped onto his back. She wondered if he still had his great-grandfather's gap-toothed smile. How could such a person have burst full-grown into her life?
Wonderful.
No, that was terrific. Thank you so much for sharing with us this evening. Let's talk a little bit about Art Sanctuary now.
Yes, great.
How did you come to found this amazing organization?
Oh, Art Sanctuary started actually with me doing book tours.
Oh.
And what happened was, that I would go to places for tours. I would have these conversations live in places and talk to people. Almost never in venues in the middle of Black communities. They were on college campuses, which I was grateful for. They were in, you know, bookstores downtown. I knew that people had literally died so that I had the right to be published by mainstream publishers and to read in bookstores downtown and at various conventions mm-hmm. and all that. But it still seemed wrong that I'm an African-American woman reading books about African-American people, and I couldn't do it in the hood.
African-American communities.
Yeah, right. Like, and not only places with money. It was also about money. So part of it was about founding an organization that would bring all kinds of African-American arts into the inner city. The other was it had to be nonprofit, in the same way the ballet company is nonprofit, because although entertainment always pays for itself, art doesn't.
Right.
Always. Do you know what? Mm-hmm. I mean, it doesn't always make money.
Exactly.
Sometimes you can manage to get it paid for, but it doesn't always make big profits, like hospitals don't, do you know? So that's a lie, some hospitals do. And some art does too, but you get my point.
Right, and so the mission of Art Sanctuary is to bring African-American art directly into African-American underprivileged communities in Philadelphia.
Correct. Now, that doesn't mean that those are the only audiences.
Of course.
Just as people in North Philly go to the Kimmel Center, similarly, we have, when we do these programs, so we have people who come from Bryn Mawr or Warminster or downtown to come into those. Because the other part of that mission is to change those communities from being drive-by to being a destination.
Right. And art is certainly always a way to enliven mm-hmm. a community
Absolutely.
And to give a community a voice then.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, there's a group here in Philadelphia called Social Impact of the Arts Project
mm-hmm.
That have done some quantitative work on it. And they
Interesting.
They take all of the attributes of a neighborhood with a functioning arts organization. And they figure out how much that's worth. So for most communities, it's worth, you know, like $200,000 a year in services because truancy goes down, even things that are not related, like
right.
house values, that kind of business. So,
okay. What's next on your horizon before you leave off with us for the evening?
Oh, dear Lord. I'm starting to think about a nonprofit, a nonfiction project that looks at all the sides of the Atlantic, look at the triangle.
Mm-hmm.
And everything starts, I'm fixated with the beginning core of every project. So this one is African-American people going to West Africa and going to those forts and having that experience.
Oh, fascinating.
So I want to start with that, you know, back and forth, past and present. What are they doing when they go there? What happens? What happened there? So I want to tell some of that story, do some middle passage work, but also look at the relationship now among Liverpool, the West Coast of Africa, and the United States.
Fascinating. Well, yeah. We look forward to reading that.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us this
Thank
evening.
You.
And audience, thank you. Good night.